of course, will determine who takes the seventh seed and who will get second choice of the opponent in the upcoming spring promotion tournament. It is a big, big game. Don't take anything away from it. Gambit, of course, found some hidden magic and look very strong in this Super Week. They are now 3-1, which honestly a lot of us would not have expected. Only dropping a single match to Alliance, which ironically they were very close to taking as well. You have to wonder where this team has been the whole time.
So we can of course say they needed time to get synergy with Coupon in the top lane. Diamond was gone for the team for 1 week, then he came back into the team. There's been a lot of issues for Gambit. They had to sort out. Clearly, it's been working out now up to Super Week, and they have looked very strong. And we have to remember, they already beat Copenhagen Wolves very first day of Super Week, where it was a close game in the start, but then as soon as Gambit actually got a lead, they completely controlled the game. They had this siege combo, this poke combo with like Zix and Gragas top lane for Coupon, and there was actually nothing Copenhagen Wolves could do to win the game in the very end. And I do want to highlight Diamond on Kha'Zix, because he played it again in this poke comp, and it's been a very strong pick for him. In the case, they like to play these poke comps and these kite comps, but itself, I don't believe it's too strong, and therefore we don't really see anyone play Kha'Zix with the involved W in any other region. But it's been working out for Gambit, and it was banned in the last game against him.
You could see management, analysts, coaches, everybody behind Gambit for this one, of course. It is a solid match for them. On the other side, of course, the Copenhagen Wolves, well, they have struggled throughout the week. They've only gone 1-3, just that picking up that singular win over Rocket.
And honestly, they still have the same issue they have had all split long. Objective control and then positioning around it. They got the very first dragon in the last game they played. The next dragon spawned, and they weren't in position to fight or take it, and end up falling behind, and it's just been the issue for Copenhagen Wolves around these objectives here. Either they pick the wrong fights or not there in time. They are a very strong team. The laning phase is good for them. We often see what actually do well in the laning phase, and once they do get a lead, we have also seen them snowball it and take games off the better teams here in Europe. So they are definitely a good team. Still fairly new with the two new members, and it might just be all about protecting Wulard here. For Copenhagen Wolves, he loves to play hyper carries. They love to build comps around him and make sure he stays safe. Remember his game against Rocket, 8 kills on Tristana very early. It was only like 32 minutes long game, and he just destroyed people.
Yeah, he got a lot of damage down on towards him. Of course, he played that Tristana early on today as well. Didn't quite work out for him so well in the previous matchup, of course. Let's check out the starting lineups for these two teams before the game gets underway. Over on the blue side, it is Gambit. That means Coupon is in that top lane. Sitting alongside him is Diamond in the jungle. Nick in the mid lane. Genja as the AD carry. And Edward on support.
And on the red side, the Copenhagen Wolves with Jumbuck in the top lane. Broken Shot as the jungler. Soren in the mid lane. Vulad as the AD carry. And Unlimited on support.
So pick and bans are going to be a big, big deal for this one. What are we expecting? You know, overall, we saw, of course, Braum being banned away last time. It's a big champion for Unlimited.
Yeah.
We talked about the Kha'Zix, maybe even the Evelynn ban potentially against Diamond, because, well, he just absolutely destroyed SK Gaming with that early Evelynn pick.
So Braum was banned last time they played each other by Gambit, where Copenhagen Wolves, who, by the way, is on the red side, so no first pick for them, it's for Gambit.
Potential Kassadin ban for
them. Yeah, Kassadin, of course,
that takes away one of their bans.
And Maokai was banned last time against Coupon. The one game in Super Week we actually did play it, he was very, very good. Otherwise, it's been banned against him every single game. Expect Copenhagen Wolves to ban again. And you have to feel they're going to ban Evelynn. After what Diamond did in the last game, he just played on Evelynn. You don't really want to risk it.
And they're going to be a little bit more cautious in the jungle, I think, Broken Shard. You know, Diamond said in his interview himself, he says he believes everyone is playing too risky in the jungle and kind of made a point of Svenska and
Blossom. Destroyed SK Gaming. Just the first 5 minutes, all of a sudden, Diamond had like 4 kills and every single lane was ahead because first he went into the jungle, killed Svenska, and honestly, unless Copenhagen Wolves have something ready against Evelynn, they have to ban it.
So here we go, ladies and gentlemen. Pick and bans underway for the final game in Europe before the quarterfinal playoffs begin next week. Quick bans coming through. Lee Sin, Braum taken away by Gambit. Surprises there, not really. And Copenhagen Wolves, well, we've called these ones so far. What are the final ones? Twitch is going to get banned away. So Warlight being the focus. I wonder if they're going to try and steal away Tristana here.
So
Zix banned final.
Okay, Zix being banned against Soren. He played in the last game. He's actually banned from Copenhagen Wolves against Gambit. Nick loves to play. We have seen this siege comp, which actually Gragas. Gambit used against Copenhagen Wolves. Should be Gragas. Maokai is still open, however, for the top lane. Ooh. So maybe Gambit just want to trade, whatever.
That's interesting. So they value Cog more over the Gragas pick and because the Orianna pick, of course, yeah. Or Sorin.
So very, very strong early picks here from Copenhagen Wolves. You get probably the best top laner at the moment. And then Orianna, the main champion from Sorin. The two times he played it, he's been doing really well. Gambit should take Maokai for top lane. Don't have to lock it in now. Can wait. Otherwise, I don't see any reason for not first picking the Gragas.
Gragas is the second best champion for Young Buck in that top lane. This is highest KDA, 2.50, opposed to the Mundo, who's only got a 1 KDA. Big difference, more importantly, is, of course, for Sorin. Played two games on that Orianna so far. It's the champion he's known for in solo queue. He's got a 4.5 KDA, and what was one of the reasons they won the game just 2 weeks ago. Gambit themselves looking to lock up Maokai, assuming that's going to be the top lane pick, and of course the Thresh Prince for Edward.
And did have a very good game on Thresh earlier. From Edward, landed a lot of hooks here, set up many, many kills for Gambit. So strong picks all around. Also because we did see some bans towards the junglers, left both top laners, which Gambit would have gone either Gragas or Maokai, most likely. So they can be happy trading here, and if Kuban gets to his late game point like we saw when he played Maokai earlier this week, he becomes almost unkillable. Which could also explain the fact that Gambit were fine leaving Gragas, also because Tristana normally doesn't build Blaze Rune King, so won't have it against the Maokai.
We'll see where the Warlight goes, of course, on that Tristana with the Static Shiv early on like he did in the previous matchup. It's a blessing and a curse sometimes. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. If you can't get the Infinity Edge stacked on top, it causes you all sorts of problems. Of course, it is going to be a Morgana for Unlimited as well. So final two choices for Nick and Diamond. What will they be? Jungle and mid lane. Evelynn, not available.
Both teams already looking very, very late game. Wouldn't surprise me to see Gambit aim for some late game mid lane as well. Looking from where Nick normally plays, I mean, he did actually play Karthus in one game. Could be an option for him, so you have Marco Diamond game followed him. But on the side of Copenhagen Wolves, because there's a Gragas, he can knock him away. And because of the long range from Tristana, there's actually nobody really collapsing onto Gambit, and therefore the Karthus pick wouldn't be able to do a lot.
Syndra would be an interesting pick. We haven't seen Nick playing that one, I don't recall. Of course, very popular over in North America and Korea, and is going to get Syndra locked in. Kha'Zix also locked in for Diamond.
Okay, so Diamond going to do his evolve W, just try and kite and poke as much as possible and jump in if a target does drop low, which is where Syndra comes into the picture. Burst down target from Copenhagen Wolves. Diamond can jump in, finish it. But on the side of Copenhagen Wolves, we have some very, very strong laners. At the moment, top lane should be in their favor, and bottom lane is going to be very hard for Gambit to deal with. Maybe in the early stages they can, while they do have some longer range from Genja. But still, there's some very strong lanes here from Copenhagen Wolves. Syndra, of course, is a great lane bully in the mid lane, but Orianna is one of the best at dealing with her because of also you have your own shield, you can run heal, and therefore survive the burst from a Syndra.
Jarvan, being a popular champion for Broken Shard, very much his favorite in the jungle, of course. He definitely is the strongest earlier jungle for him, he believes himself. The words that you've no doubt heard were from his mouth as well. But Jarvan has worked, honestly, for them. It's generally that when they do get Jarvan, it seems to be what sets them up. And of course, Broken Shard being the main shot caller for the Wolves, if he can get going, he gets the rest of the team going. And honestly, I think the Wolves have got everything they wanted in that pick and ban phase.
I believe so as well. I don't really believe they mind giving over a pick to Genja as the first pick from Gambit, and then get Gragas and Orianna on their side, two of the strongest picks they can get for the solo laners, which normally are the lanes. When we do look at Copenhagen Wolves, who tends to have issues and therefore need some strong laners, but we see the same deal. Strong lanes, good early game jungler, look to get a lead early, get the first dragon, and now make sure to get the second dragon as well, and therefore keep the gold lead. Otherwise, Gambit might get to the point where they can pick it up, get ahead, and then we have seen, once Gambit are ahead, they know how to play it now. A lot of poke, take control, and therefore force Copenhagen Wolves out.
Well, we'll see how it works out, ladies and gentlemen. Who do you think has come out ahead in this one after the pick and ban phase? Tweet us, hashtag GMB win or hashtag MIL win for Millennium and Gambit. To Millennium. At Lodi Sports.
And CW course, win.
It does say MIL win. Yeah, it should be CW win. Trying to throw me off there for the Copenhagen Wolves. Millennium are safe in the playoffs. Don't worry about that, ladies and gentlemen. So, Copenhagen Wolves, with, honestly, I think most of their happy champions. I don't think Gambit have come out too bad either. Of course, Diamond's been playing Kha'Zix 3 out of 4 games, worked out well. I'm interested to see how Syndra works for Nick. Yeah, that's the big one for me. That's a big question mark.
It's going to be a lot about Nick in this mid game, where Gambit does have the chance to get the lead, while Vulad still have to scale up on this Tristana, where he has his weak point. So we have to see a great performance from Nick here.
Well, here we go, ladies and gentlemen. The final game of Super Week underway. It's the tiebreaker. It is for 7th and 8th place. Who will be facing the bottom of the table at the end of this? Gambit, you'd have thought, honestly, at the start of the summer, it would be unheard of for them to be down there alongside the Copenhagen Wolves, who themselves, of course, went through the promotion series last split.
It's going to be very risky for Gambit, though, in these team fights, because only Diamond can actually jump out of Jarvan's ulti, and you also have Orianna, so now Brokenjar can get the ball from Soren, jump in, and if there's no flash on Genji or Nick, they can instantly blow them up here in these fights. So the engage is definitely in favor of Copenhagen Wolves in that case, where Gambit has to rely on Kuban going in, snaring a target, and then they just come in with the stun from Nick and the burst. Otherwise, they're just going to have to try and sit back and poke, which is what they like to do. But both teams, with some good late game comps here, will still, because Copenhagen Wolves just have the Jarvan and Orianna combo here, say they are the ones who can dictate the game.
You see the Doran shield coming out from Edward once again, so we'll see whether he's going to be a bit more aggressive in the early lane phases down that bottom half. Of course, it looks like the Wolves may well be changing things up here.
Yeah.
They fancy taking the top lane pair, and you see Unlimited heading up there. Minions you already spawned. See Warlight going across the top lane as well, so the Wolves are lane swapping.
And it is the issue when you start Doran shield on a support. It's good to get the instant combat stats if you are in a 2v2 lane, but once the lane swap hits, you lose out on a lot of gold, and it's kind of a deadweight item you all of a sudden have on you here, so not paying off for Edward, starting with the Doran shield.
Well, the Wolves pass on by a ward. Gambit know exactly where they are. And they also know that the lane swap is on, which is why we see Edward already moving in, getting securing the blue buff over there. It's going to be a delayed blue buff, that's for sure, for Gambit. The Wolves in position much earlier on. Youngmug sticking around, making sure he doesn't steal the experience from Broken Shard there, so he will hit level 2 first. Or Youngmug, meanwhile, moves around to the Wolves. So, buddy system very much in effect. Kuban also doing similar alongside Diamond down in the lower half. So, we'll see how this works out. Gambit put a lot of focus on that dragon. Copenhagen Wolves have made some indecisive moves on the dragon. With the lane swaps, it always becomes a problem.
Yeah, so Copenhagen Wolves have to send down Unlimited around the dragon pretty much already now.
Well,
if they wanted to stop Gambit from doing it, but because Gambit knew Copenhagen Wolves started their blue buff and can still see Unlimited up in his top lane or just saw him move beforehand, they feel confident enough to start it, but they still have to dance around it. Not take too much damage. Kuban already dropping that low.
Yeah, they're not juggling it at the best, honestly. It's
no.
A little bit of an awkward angle. It's not working out too well, this juggle. Nonetheless, it will go down. You can see it's almost finished off there, so they're not able to quite dodge all of the damage. It's going to be Kuban's going to take a couple of hits. Eddie taking very low. It's going to get finished off right now. So Gambit take first dragon of the game. 3 minutes 14.
But still, this is why some teams feel it's too risky to take the early dragon, because if Copenhagen Wolves had been there just with 2 members, and Gambit was so low, it would have been 2 easy kills, maybe even the dragon. So it was a bit of a risky move here, but they felt confident enough doing it because they expected Copenhagen Wolves to stay on the top side of the map. A bit of an issue or a bit of a mistake from the Wolves, they didn't actually send down Unlimited beforehand with Broken Shot and Youngbok to make sure this dragon didn't get started. And now they're going to check and see. Oh, it's gone.
Unlimited might land the dart binding. No, not going to quite land. Instead, a tower hit will go down. Unlimited suddenly gets unleashed damage on him from Nick. Forces the flash away. Ignite was used by Nick. Thought he could get the kill there. But good, good reactions.
Oh, Broken Shot around his mid lane.
Still got flash available, remember. Didn't use it last time around. This time he is going to get caught out. Will he flash? Yes, he will. Gets away safe. And we'll see whether Broken Shard decides to pay a second visit there in a moment.
So Nick actually decided to take all the damage because he wanted to delay his flash, even though he knew he had to use it after. Should have just instant flash. As soon as he saw the flag, you flash away. Don't take the damage, just stay in the lane as healthy as possible. Let's see here. Broken Shard want to get down and help Youngbok in his bottom side. Genji just been happy farming. Same goes for Wulad in the top lane.
Yeah, and it looks like Kubon's not actually going to go towards that top lane just yet. He's happy to stick away. Of course, Wulad freezing that lane up, so wouldn't really be able to get a great deal from that one, Kubon. So instead, he's going to stick around buddy system. It's going to delay Diamond's farm for a while because, well, Youngbok was off in his own down the bottom. Now he's also joined Broken Shard. So both of these top lane junglers using the buddy system and going around that jungle as a parry.
Notice Wulad here. He only has one rank in his queue at the moment. Didn't level up anything else at this point. Just saving it because he doesn't need it. He's just standing here freezing the lane and farming it. So once we go back to standard lanes...
I mean, he obviously doesn't want the explosive shot.
Yeah, of course.
So he can keep his lane frozen. Yeah.
It's actually pretty smart because he doesn't need anything other than just his auto attacks at this point. And therefore just sitting and waiting to see what's going to happen. Broken Shard back to farming. We did see him with a pretty good gang in the mid lane, got a lot of damage onto Nick. You can notice how he used both health potions now because he didn't flash instantly. And now two members up in his top side to push it.
Well, instead, they're going to try and shove it, reset the wave into the tower. Brawlite doesn't have leveled up yet. We'll see whether he has. Now he has. Explosive shot goes onto Diamond. And he is still trying to hold that line. Look at it. He's pulled it completely away from the tower. Nicely done, Brawlite.
But now he does have the explosive shots. Going to be a lot harder to actually freeze it, and we might see Copenhagen Wolves either swap their lanes around and try and get the dual lane down to this bottom side, at least around the time where the next dragon will spawn, so they don't have to give it up as well to Gambit. They have not been doing any kind of pushing in this top side, but now he will be actually forced to push it down, so therefore Kubon can return to this top lane alone and just wait for the wave to come down. Oh, scumbag.
Interrupted, Broken Shard. Backing off himself, puts the Demacia standard down. Sorin may also do the same again to Nick. He should be able to back off and get himself a chalice.
But it's a great play.
On Sorin, though, he is continuing his farm in that mid lane, of course, on his most favored champion. So pressure always going to be on Nick on that Syndra. Youngbok, he's gone quite far up the lane now, trying to get close to get some of that experience, not working out for him. Has got a bit of a CS lead over Kubon, who has now returned also to this top lane. He should be able to farm this one out now that it's, of course, reset onto his tower. That will give him his experience and much-needed gold.
Yeah, it seems like Copenhagen Wolves just want to swap it around now, send Youngbok back to this top lane, and send Unlimited and Wulad to this bottom side, where Genji is level 5 and currently sitting. I'm just farming the waves here, waiting now for Copenhagen Wolves to make the move. He did already go back, picked up a Phage, nowhere Sheen, so not looking to do the small instant trade on Kog'Maw you can do, and just boom, one hit and you, like, away. So let's see here. Very standard. We're actually just waiting for the next dragon. None of the junglers have been very active lately.
It's a Phage versus a BF sword down that bottom lane right now in terms of AD carries. We'll see whether Wulad decides to go aggressive. Of course, extra hit points are required for Genja. Death Sentinel lands, he goes in, Eddie in there. Black Shield is going to be used already. Genja's going to put the damage down, just hit level 6, forces him away. Nice play from Gambit.
A very nice setup here. And Edward on Thresh, he did the same thing earlier today where he just landed the hooks, set up a lot of kills here, and forced Wulad back. He just came down to the lane. Unlimited.
He's got Death Sentence. Ooh, missed it badly. Oh, Unlimited taken low.
One more hit
would have been enough. Instead, didn't use it. Nonetheless, that's going to force the wave on towards the tower, and they could get a good chunk of damage. Wulad is making his way back down here, but there's a lot of CS he's going to miss out on.
If the cannon minion actually dies here before he comes down, he will lose out on also the melee minions. Yes, now he's coming down here. Lost a lot of CS from this. A lot of gold. Potential gold.
Oh, Death Sentinel's not going to land. Black Shield this time did go down in time. Instead, he went on towards the minion. Genja forces him back again. Tries to trade with Wulad. Got to be careful. He has got that BF sword after all. It will put some damage out there. Didn't go with the Sonic Shear first item this time around there.
And we just see both teams here playing it very safe in the start. It's all about just, okay, can we land the skill shot, try and poke down. Genji didn't even want to try and force the flash away from Copenhagen Wolves. As soon as they jumped away or just moved away from Genji, he stopped. Didn't want to try and force anything, didn't want to take any chance. If the jungler had been there from Copenhagen Wolves, could have backfired for him. So just playing it safe. Oh, Edward.
Black Shield on towards him this time around. Could have gone with the Flay to start with. Was close enough. Bit to land. Oh, Dark Binding lands. Genshin now gonna take some damage. Woolite in trouble though. Flay available. Death Sentence. Will he get thrown out? No. Will stop. Diamond was nearby. Has hit level 6. Guessing he's evolved his Void Spikes like he has been doing throughout the entire split so far. Eddie, Death Sentence this time was thrown to Unlimited. Black Shielded, guessed right.
But they keep forcing Woolite away from these minions here, so it's actually working out for them. Dragon is also alive. And then once again, Woolite taking a lot of damage here. Genji, however, is down to 50% because of all the trading. But Dragon is alive. Both top laners also have teleport. And at the moment, nobody is making a move.
Diamond's going to get spotted out by that ward that Broken Shard just placed. So bottom lane know that they are safe for now. Eddie burning down with that rocket explosive shot on him. Oh, hello. Youngbuck going aggressive on towards Kubon, who uses his ultimate to make sure he's safe. Pretty quick cooldown on that skill. But we'll be down for a while. Let's see whether they're trying to create a play from this one. Gambit continue pushing forward. This pressure in this bottom lane is starting to create a big problem for Woolite in terms of CS. You can see he's falling further and further behind. Diamond, he's been spotted by a ward, but it does call to action Broken Shard, who has just backed the base, in fact. So if Edward was to catch anything on Woolite, he would go down.
And they are just going to try and force Copenhagen Wolves to move away from this tower again and lose even more CS. Diamond is poking on here. Might take some damage, but still the whole idea is to force Woolite away from these minions here so he won't be able to kill them.
Yeah, Woolite desperately getting closer again. Void Spikes not landing this time. Caught on towards him. There's the ultimate. One more shot to do it. He didn't go pull the trigger. Genja. He had the W available. Didn't use it.
Playing it very, very safe. Didn't use the ult either to, once again, either force a summoner or at least Woolite to jump away. Okay. So Gambit, it's actually a very smart move because they did force Woolite back to base, can now go towards the dragon. And two members from Copenhagen Wolves are here too.
A shockwave in an enclosed environment like this dragon pit is always risky. Nick, we have to stun down. Unlimited gonna get caught out. There's the ultimate used. That's Unlimited down, but that's not great. Eddie's very low. Youngbuck comes in. He's gonna try and catch on. Youngbuck, Kubon dancers catch on towards him. This dragon's still not gone down. Will get smited down, but Diamond pays the price. Youngbuck's gonna get picked off on the side now. Kubon goes in, locks up Broken Shard. The rest of Gambit reacting. Woolite comes around the side. They need to shut Youngbuck down. Woolite's gonna count towards him. Genji's in trouble. Gets in towards the bush. Nick lands the stun, but it's not on the right target. Eddie throws out the lantern. Genji gets away safe, and Gambit back away. A 2-for-2 trade, and the dragon for Gambit. The question is, will they get this bottom turret?
At least pushing in here, Unlimited coming from the base. Everyone else from Gambit needs to go back to base, and here should be a tower for Copenhagen Wolves. So 2-for-2, first blood for Nick. I have to remember, once again, it's Gambit. They want to set up these fights here. They had some very nice poke, very nice foreplay, we could even say, before they started the dragon. But in Copenhagen Wolves, they are still a team who constantly wants to contest fights, or contest dragons. They want to fight. And that's why they stayed, even though Woolite wasn't there.
Eddie sticking around just to milk out that experience from range. Almost got out of position by Unlimited. Genja back in that bottom lane. He's going to wipe out that wave. CS-wise, Woolite, of course, gained a chunk back, but Genja will regain that power. Nick getting himself the blue wolf. Athene's now completed. Trinity Force picked up by Genja. Infinity Edge yet to be taken by Woolite. May be close to getting the VAT money for it. Actually, a little bit short at the moment, still only on 600 gold, so he's got a little way to go on that one. So, once this blue buff's traded across to Sorin, how do we count this one? Because the game is going to start opening up now those towers are starting to fall.
So up in his top lane at least, there's a big difference in how strong they are at this point, especially Youngbuck, because he went triple Dorn, so he's delaying his Rod of Ages. Has been pressuring out Kubon, making sure he could always push it down, get all the farm here. Doesn't really do a lot of damage on the Kubon, he's very tanky and will get the Rod of Ages first. So scaling into late game, Kubon definitely has the advantage. Also the fact he's going to get Rod of Ages earlier than Youngbuck.
And you saw in that fight, of course, the presence that Kubon does have. Nick
still very far behind in
defending out against four members of Copenhagen Wolves in this mid lane. Stun being used, just poking down Sorin. Wait, we'll get cleared out. Genja down the bottom, continue to farm. That's going to put pressure in towards this mid lane. Diamond's Void Spikes are only going to do so much as Nick continues to try and wipe the wave. Sorin hooked in. Tower hit will land. Good shield comes out. Defensive ball and black shield being used. to save him. While this is all happening, remember, Genja is getting all of that free experience, all of that free farm down this bottom lane. Warlight will have to go down and deal with him.
And he already has their Trinity Force completed, so very, very strong points from Genja now. We have seen him build in Vintage, as his second item of Blade of the Rune King could also be an option for him. Still, he's going to look towards some defensive items, maybe a Guardian Angel fairly early on, after his second damage item like we have seen before.
Genja forces Warlight out of the river, makes him sure he has to use that rocket jump and go around towards his tower. Diamond will get spotted out, that ward giving vision to the Copenhagen walls. So this tower will fall though. I don't think Warlight can hold on to this one. Genja simply waiting, letting the minions get taken down. Nick flash instantly this time around. That's what he needed to do. Got away quickly from Broken Shard.
Sadly, Soren couldn't actually join in here because he got stunned by Nick. Soon as Broken Shard appeared, the stun landed onto Soren. He couldn't shockwave, even though Nick was actually knocked up here. Once again, they forced a flash and can now look to do the exact same thing. Ulti is still ready for Broken Shard. Let's go straight for Nick.
Oh, Death Sentence is not going to be sidestepped, but he could get the flay. No. Rocket Jump used, gets out of there. Eddie pressuring Warlight, who has fallen quite considerably far behind on Genja right now. Suddenly, you know, at the right time, Genja's found himself an AD carry that works.
Yeah, well, he's not playing Caitlyn. Works for once. And he's been looking very good in Super Week. So I'm playing Corki as well. His Tristana was a bit too manly, but didn't actually have a bad game on it. So he's been looking good on any other champion than Caitlyn here in the LCS. And let's see, Broken Shot once again around his mid lane. We just talked about how there's no flash on Nick. There's ulti for Broken Shard and Shockwave from Soren. So Nick is dead if he's caught in the middle of the lane.
Warlight's pushing out this bottom. Got the support of Unlimited nearby. Genja continues to take away the golems, shove the wave back, defend it in that inner, and continue the pressure. Gambit with the advantage right now. Just 90 seconds until that dragon comes back up. Broken Shard's going to go back off. Rod of the Ages completed by both top laners, along with his mid laners now, Source Boots and Athenes. We'll see which way either of those deviate. Right now they are staying very much standard build. Nick's clearing out these waves, no problem, as he starts to catch in terms of CS.
Yeah, the good thing for Soren is he can always clear the wave, go up to his own, into his own jungle, take a Wraith camp, take the Wolf camp, as long as Broken Shard isn't there, and just keep picking up some extra farm. Nick has been trying to do the same thing in here, so we haven't actually seen too much trading between the two mid laners. And we just saw Komodin was either sent Broken Shard in or four members to pressure the tower once Genji was freezing the bot lane. Now they're just kind of playing the same game. Keep the AD carries in the bot lane, keep the top lane. Top lane is up in the top side. And then everyone else is around this mid lane here, waiting again for Dragon. About 20 seconds, not a lot of wards.
Ooh, hello. Yet. Warlight's gonna have to run from this one. He's gonna jump away. Nefertix lands with it. Nicely done. Ultimate available. Exhaust goes down. Genja catches on towards him. He takes
Gambit.
The lantern. And Genja gets in. The dragon spawns right now. And they're gonna move straight for it.
Oh, that was such a nice setup here by Hit. But he was actually shot away by Woolite, but still just connected the hook. Went for it. Picked up a kill. Picked up a Baron. And even putting a pressure onto this top tower.
It looks great.
Oh, let's just see it. And shoot him away. It's already in the air. Oh. That is beautiful.
Flying Edward.
Flying
who'd have thought?
Big boss Eddie.
Dragon picked up by Gambit. Warlight will go down. That's the replay of that one. They've already picked it up. The question is, can they take some kills? They've left, of course, the top lane free for Kubon, who is pushing that one in. Youngbuck had joined them to try and interrupt that dragon. And that's a tower and a dragon picked up off that one kill. Gambit step into the lead now with a 4,500 gold advantage.
But I'm not sure why Copenhagen was actually send Youngbuck down to the mid lane. He did have teleport. Already lost the AD carry, so dragon was most likely gone. Instead of staying in his top lane, defend his own tower. So now they gave up a tower here. Broken Shard though. Might look for fight.
Oh, flashes from the shockwave. Now the stun comes in. Broken Shard takes some damage. The Black Shield mitigating some of it, but he was taken very low. That was the ultimate burn from Nick.
So two towers for Gambit. But the last few dragons are now putting pressure on this mid lane. Talk about all the poke they have, especially also with Diamond maxing his W you and involving it.
Oh, Woodline stunned, hooked. In goes Eddie. Genja strikes. And now Edward, he's even going to save this one. He will live. The tower needs to be focused, guys. That's what you need to be looking towards now. Genja's putting the damage down on towards that one. Minion wave has been cleared out. Nick will tank the last hit. But Gambit, they're stepping it up as they have done all Super Week. And Youngbuck is in trouble now in the top wave with Kubon using that ultimate to save out the tower once again. Diamond sneaks in. He steals away the blue buff. Everything is slipping away from the Copenhagen Wolves here.
And all of a sudden here now, if Broken Shell wants to engage, because Copenhagen Wolves is falling so far behind, he's just going to die instantly, and they can't really use this Orianna Jarvan combo. And now?
Look how confident Genja is. Genja has been, it's a different man
this kills.
Super Week. He's managed to take down the tower and everybody dancing around, taking the aggro from it. And it's another tower down. All outers now down for Gambit as they keep the pressure onto Gambit, to Copenhagen Wolves.
So last dragon, Copenhagen Wolves lost it due to Woolite being caught by Edward. Now they lost the mid tower as well. Exact same deal. Edward onto Woolite, kill him, take the tower. Now Youngbuck, getting to the point where the top laners can't really kill each other because of the Rod of Ages, and none of them is actually designed to kill a tank or a tree or a fat man, depends. Let's see, Broken Shadow is up in this top lane. Edward started to roam around, already landed a few very nice hooks.
Kubon tries to draw him in, takes the minion wave. Youngbuck's like, no, 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 don't like that, don't like that, backing out. Doesn't fancy it, spider sense is working. Diamond was also waiting to pounce across, has leveled up, evolved his wings as level 11. He would have jumped in there. It's going to be a safe cleanup for Kubon. Eddie is farming out, getting the experience on that, honestly, while this is all happening. It's giving Genja some free farm as well, who is now way ahead in terms of Waller.
And we'll go for his vintage, second item, and possibly Garden Angel as the next one, which he likes to do. But we have to see.
That's a big advantage. 2,500 gold ready.
Again, it's dragons, towers, all the kills as well. It seems every single time Gambit puts a lot of focus on the bot lane, especially from Diamond, they do get some kills on Genja. And it works for them because they use it in to take Dragon to get the gold lead. Last game against Copenhagen Wolves. Tuesday, first day of Super Week. Same deal. A lot of focus on getting Genja and Edward ahead. A lot of focus on getting dragons. And Copenhagen Wolves fell too far behind, could never engage onto Gambit, and end up losing the game. And at the moment, it's looking like pretty much the same deal.
If only we'd have seen this Gambit showing their faces earlier on in the summer, they may not have been in this situation in the first place. As it is though, they are looking strong. And honestly, any challenger team watching this one may need to be a little bit fearful of getting Gambit as your team to face. Diamond continuing on this Kha'Zix. Always still building, a lot of damage. It's what he's worked so far. Manages to shove those waves up. But more importantly for me, Nick, on Syndra. We haven't seen him on it, I don't believe, as far as I'm
maybe
aware.
Maybe once.
I don't recall seeing it before anyway myself. Obviously, he was niddly a lot before the changes on that. But it's a champion that's worked for him. 1-0-2, keeping up farm well with Sorin, who's on his favorite champion in that mid lane. And he is building very well and using those stuns to great effect.
Both mid laners doing a good job in the game. Sorin has been farming the jungle, his own lane. Woolite almost caught out once again by Edward. But it's just Gambit at the moment in control now. Can wait for next dragon, do the exact same they've been doing before. Try and look for one pick onto to Copenhagen Wolves, kill him, go back to dragon. And the Wolves, because they are behind, it becomes so hard for them to engage the fights because they need to make sure they have the number advantage, or they catch someone from Gambit out of position as soon as the fight starts and just blow them up with the Orianna Shockwave. Otherwise, Gambit will be able to just re-engage and win it because they are stronger at the point.
Well, Genja's even taken away the race. Literally nothing being given to Broken Shard unless you use Smite and steal away the big race. So he got that gold nonetheless. So, top laners, while it's a gold advantage for Youngbuck in terms of CS, Kubon is actually the one starting to apply some pressure. Of course, both of those very big tanks. But Copenhagen Wolves right now, they dare not go near their own jungle. You can see the timer on the dragon up, 12 seconds. Youngbuck's backing off to base. He's not going to be there in time.
Oh, Woolite might be in trouble.
Woolite's in trouble. Kubon comes around. Oh, not quite close enough. Of course, that twisted advance short at range these days, so he wasn't able to jump on him quite so quick before that rocket jump, and instead Broken Shot gets focused. Not a lot of damage though from Nick.
No, but still, Edward took a lot of damage from Soren here. Oh, he'll connect.
Oh, Death Sentence goes in there. Now Broken Shard's in trouble.
And that's a dragon.
This time Nick does have the damage, powers him down. Soren gets stunned out as well. Genja running interference. They need to sweep out that ward. They're not going to go for it. They're worried about their middle to lane turret instead. Soren pulls Shockwave. Only catches on Diamond. Lantern gets thrown out there. He's going to catch on.
Big
what
boss
in
Eddie.
Trouble. Big Boss Eddie pulling the moves out. Nick gets himself a third kill of the game.
Every single assist here from Eddie has just been such a nice setup. First onto Broken Shard, now onto Woolite. Again, Dragon for Gambit, set up by Edward. He lands the hook here. They get a kill, get another objective, even more gold. And Copenhagen Wolves, they tried to look for a fight. Didn't have the wards, didn't have the control around the river to actually spot out Gambit. And instead, Big Boss Eddie is coming for you.
4 out of 4, Dragons, blue buff going, Diamond picks that up, Genja around the side there as they put the pressure on towards the in-hit turret down the bottom, and actually, that is nearly gone. Genja's burned that turret right down, he fancies it, he's taking it. That's 4 out of 4.
And we just have to say, in this Super Week, Gambit has clearly looked like the stronger team. Copenhagen Wolves have had a lot of issues. They did win a game against Rocket, where they played really well. Otherwise, it didn't actually work for them. Gambit, on the other hand, same tactic, same strategy as every single game they played in Super Week. Focus on getting Genji ahead in the bot lane, and then just full focus on Dragon. Every time Dragon spawns, they set up a lot of good wards, spot out whatever team they're playing against, get a kill, get the Dragon, and it's just been their tactic. We're just going to see it again. Soren, he actually wants to get Genji here, only gets Diamond, and then... Oh, Edward. Whoop, too late.
Not going to get away. Hook me there. And Eddie strikes again. Fantastic. Well, he was known as the Thresh Prince way back when
he
first came onto the scene, and it seems that Edward has been working that champion back into his champion pawn. It's working wonders for him. Woolite.
He's going to have nightmares of Eddie.
I wouldn't like to play against him, that's for sure, right now. He definitely seems to be stepping his form up. The question is, can they keep this up? Of course, Promotion Series is some way away right now. Oh, Diamond hops out the way from that Dark Binding. They've got to see who they're going to play. Well, of course, they've had the whole Super Week to sit and prepare for this one. They didn't go back to Russia or their homelands or wherever that may well be. Instead, they stuck around here in Cologne in the studios and practiced hard. Can they do that again? That's the question. The fabled boot camp of Gambit, of course, used to be a big thing, but as of late, it has caused more problems than it created.
Yeah, but still, the more time they get to play with Kubanov in his top lane and also find their playstyle, which they seem to have done.
Death Sentence again on Broken Shard this time. The rest of the team were not there to react. Broken Shard going aggressive on Eddie. Doesn't land it this time around, but Nick's nearby. Could throw out the stun. Woolite going to pounce away from this one. Diamond does pounce through. The rest of Gambit pushing up the mid line. Copenhagen Wolves out of position here. Remember, there's no inner turret off just off of the side. Instead, they're going to come jumping in. Broken Shard pounces, catches on towards Genja. The belly slam, ironically, knocking him out of that one. The Lancer not pulling Nick to safety. Nick will go down. Genja gets a kill on towards Broken Shard. Kubon very low on health. And Gambit this time are in the retreat.
Oh,
another hook goes in. Unlimited low. Soren low. Can Genja get on towards them? Ultimate goes out. Unlimited taken so low. Genja gets the speed on towards it. Woolite pounces. Shockwave pulls Genja in towards the tower. He will go down at last. And no, Gatekathian surprise flashed away from. Will not get Soren down. And wow, Copenhagen Wolves finally coming out in the advantage 1-2.
But that was a very, very nice engage by Broken Shard. However, there was no Shockwave. I don't believe Soren was actually in range to use it, even though both Nick and Genja were caught.
Used on Genja.
Used it in the very end, of course. I mean, as soon as the engage came, just once we get the replay, we can actually check what happened with Soren here. But still, Copenhagen Wolves showing they're not done yet. And Gambit just chasing for the very, very last kills and end up being caught. So let's see. Broshard goes in for the engage. Soren is actually way too far away. He's not in range to use the Shockwave here. So Nick and Genji, even though they were caught, the two squishy members, Copenhagen Wolves did manage to just blow them up here. End up trading one for one in the start. And now it's all about Genji looking for more kills. Hook onto Unlimited. He gets very low now. He has to flash away. And Genji just want to land two of his ulties to kill him. And in the very end, it's a good Shockwave by Soren to actually kill Genji.
So mid turret went down. The Wolves managed to sneak in and get that one. Now Gambit back in full force. So Copenhagen Walls retreating back to safety of their turrets. Gambit, gotta be careful. Warning signs there. Infinity Edge and Static Shift now completed for Wallite, so will be able to do range damage and start to put the pressure on. And as we've seen so many times with Orianna, a good shockwave on the right target can be crucial. They're trying to bait Gendry into coming closer there instead. Sorin will get that Golem down.
Especially because Gambit is running this two damage threat where they only have Genji and Nick as the damage dealers. Kuban is going to be very tanky now. Yumruk want to look for a fight here.
Yeah, teleported in. He's going to go towards them. Shockwave is back up. Instead, Lantern's going to get thrown out. Stun does not land on Yumruk. Dragon open over
nice
a minute
down.
The Wolves, I'm not sure if they're missing the timing on that one or whether they just wanted to create an opportunity early on. Death Sentence misses. Stun misses. The Wolves force them back.
But this next dragon fight here, there's no flash on Genji. He's going to be the target for Broken Shot, so as long as they can actually combine it with the Shockwave, they might be able to kill him and therefore win the fight. Because again, as I just said before, Gambit is only running Genji as Nick and Nick as the two damage dealers. Diamond, he evolves his W. So not a full focus on single target damage, more poke, long fights. And of course, Kuban in the top lane of Maokai is not exactly going to kill people by himself in the late game. He can still do some damage, but not exactly the same amount as a Gragas, who's building a lot of AP.
Well, we are absolutely going to see the dragon fight. Will it be the right decision for the Wolves? You've got to be questioning this one. Void Staff was completed by Nick in the last back. He's got a power advantage over Sorin, but if Gambit were to get caught in this pit by that shockwave, it could be critical. Gambit waiting off at the side. The Copenhagen Wolves waiting. Dragon up in 4 seconds time. Will spawn now. Will they go for it? Or will they try and pressure instead the middle turret? I wonder what Gambit choose. They put a lot of value in this dragon. They want to stick around. They want to go for it. Kuban may well be the opening trigger. He goes in. Stun doesn't really do a great deal from Nick this time around. Copenhagen Wolves trying to draw advantage. Again, skill shots hitting left and right. None of them quite connected. Diamond's taken pretty low. He gets the smite in. Gambit are going to get out.
And Copenhagen Wolves on the wrong side here. Gambit can move straight up to the mid lane, push it into the tower, get a few hits, play some ward here and actually spot the Wolves. Oh, they might just try and bait them on here. Let's see. Copenhagen Wolves should be looking for a fight.
Kuban out of position. He's 5v1 in. He's going to take a lot of damage. There's a Lantern there. Instead, he decides to go aggressive. Not sure is the right choice. Jungbuk can get the explosive cast down to the right target. Diamond taken low. Eddie almost dropped straight away by Jungbuk. He's fleeing from this one. Jungbuk should be able to shut him down. Stun comes out. Eddie gets the flay down. It's not going to be enough to save his life. Diamond now going to get caught out. He gets slow. Nick off the side there. He will take down Unlimited, but now he's being pursued. The quick pancake
not
towards
the
Broken Shot jumping in. Doesn't matter. Shockwave comes in. That's going to be the Wolves. They can turn straight for Baron.
Going straight for Baron. Genji is alive and Diamond with smite ready. He's still very, very low. Let's see if they can actually steal it. Broken Shot needs to be careful as well.
Genji's still alive, remember, they're in an enclosed space, and that's a long range AD carry to do some damage on you. Wallite getting focused. Look at that! Just two shots, takes him so low. Jungbuk catches on towards him, they have to turn back on towards him. Genji now pulled him out of it. Sorin taking so low. Defensive ball.
Oh,
is it going to be enough?
No,
spikes don't land on it. Diamond coming in.
Come
here comes Kuban back around the side there. Genji, what target will he focus on? They have to pick this one right. They have to play this right. Kuban, Jungbuk gets jumped on. Diamond finds it, gets the reset, comes around, broken. Shot chased down, voice box that double kill for Diamond, and Gambit engage on the Baron.
So now Gambit's turn here. Four members of Copenhagen Wolves started the Baron. They were already very low here, and it was all about Genji and Diamond. Beautiful play by Genji, especially back and forth. He kept hitting every single member. Now it's Wulad. Turn to do the same.
He's going to see if he can get the poke down. Smite, of course, is available for Diamond. Broken Shard not up there. This is going to be a tough steal. Wallite is going to be the one that tries to get it. One more shot. Oh, so close. But the smite is there. Diamond secures it for Gambit.
All right, so Gambit with the Baron here, but still warning signs. The last team fight, definitely in favor of Copenhagen Wolves, because Gambit, four members were caught on one side of the wall, and then Kuban was all alone. He didn't take the Lantern, ended up dying. And Copenhagen Wolves could just chase Gambit, kill them, start the Baron, and it was honestly fantastic play by Genji. Dodging around all the damage from Copenhagen Wolves, and he just kept switching between the targets. Everyone dropped low. Let's see it again. Diamond is really low. He's all about poking here, and Genji as well, full HP. So much damage from Baron onto Copenhagen Wolves, they can't really take it, and now it's all about Genji dancing around. Survives first, dodges, hits Broken Shot, now it's onto Sorin, moves on here, and now Diamond can jump in, misses the first one. Nice little dodge by Copenhagen Wolves, and then Kuban from behind. and just chasing off, getting two kills, and also the Baron.
I reckon Kuban must have had a quadra kill in his mind there. If I can get in there with my ulti running, just pop it, I might get all four. It didn't work out for him nonetheless. And now Gambit with the Baron buff. Can they push up? They've already taken one inner turret down in the bottom lane. Can they rotate and take this one down? Pull straight up there. Kuban's not with them, so they're only four members. And they have got a big, big wave doing the pushing for them down in the lower half of the map. Genja. What a destructive machine he is right now on Cogmore. It's a champion that seems to be working for him. Infinity Edge, Trinity Force, he's a big, big build. Oh, he's going to be the focus. Lantern nice is there, though. Broken Shard tried something, but that's risky. Risky, risky maneuver doing that in open play against the Baron up team.
Yeah, and there was flash for Genji, but didn't have to use it because of the Lantern here. So Copenhagen Wolves tried to force it. Didn't work, and now back to the same deal.
Oh, look at this though. We're going to have Woolite's going to go in the top. He's going to show himself. There's a mini wave coming in. Mid tower is absolutely going to be in trouble. Kuban's wave is going to get cleared out. He's not going to get close there, but the mid tower is the focus now. Gambit will move in towards that one. They should be able to get the damage down. Genja working it down. You can see, of course, no ultimate available for Broken Shard. He just used it, and that's the tower down.
Easy tower here because Copenhagen Wolves are splitting up, not using again the Gragas to wave, they're not using the Tristana to wave clear. So it's all about Zorn, and he can't do it alone. And Gambit, oh, in the jungle here.
Well, we've
Edward didn't want to hook.
Of course, Jezzy's yesterday catching that beautiful three-man Orianna ultimate in the jungle. This time around, Zorn wasn't able to catch them unawares in the bush. Gambit looking to take the final inner turret. Minion wave on the bottom, while it was cleared slightly by Youngbuck, is going to continue pushing, I think, for Gambit. Now Gambit themselves will keep the pressure on this top wave. All they need to do is just buy a couple of time. Genji can just walk up, get some long range hits on that tower, and it will be taken very low. He's got to be careful though. Explosive cask is up for Youngbuck. He wants to slam flash, get in there, blow Genji in towards him. He will go down, and that big damage dealer, once he's down, will cause a problem for Copenhagen Wolves.
Look at all the poke from Gambit. Diamond is actually standing down here. Oh, just jumping away. But he kept just running up, trying to hit Copenhagen Wolves from the side, but Genji did the same.
Ooh, a lot of damage to Nick. Dark Binding landing. Nick goes down. Get straight in towards it. Broken Shard, though, he drops straight away. Diamond getting the reaction on that one. He's going to pounce. He gets reset on towards Zorin. Zorin, no. He will drop. And Limited's going on towards there. The Soul Shackles will proc, but not doing enough. And Genji gets himself the kill. It's a 3-for-1 trade for Gambit. And they can keep on pushing.
So while Nick died very fast, as soon as Bongshot jumped in, it's the thing about Jarvan. If you are behind and you jump in, you're gonna die every single time. Gambit easily kill him and then just chase on, going for Inhibitor.
Inhibitor turret will go down here. Baron buff still on them. It's about to wear off. It's got about 10 seconds remaining as they keep on pushing. Woolite backing away from this one. Inhibitor gets worked on. Genji will follow that one. The question is, will Gambit finish? They used to be able to finish games in a matter of a minute, the first Inhibitor going down. It doesn't look like they're gonna be able to do it this time around, but so far, they are looking good to take 7th.
And Dragon is alive again. Gonna be number 6 for Gambit here. Not a single one for Copenhagen Wolves. Baron for Gambit as well. Oh, the towers. There's so much global gold for Gambit in this game. And it all started just from the start with the very first Dragon for Gambit into lane swap. Copenhagen Wolves didn't want to send down Unlimited, or didn't actually have time to do it because Gambit did the Dragon so fast, took a lot of damage for it. But that's the very first one. And from there on, it was all about Edward catching Woolite, getting the next Dragon for Gambit. And then he caught a Broken Shard, next Dragon again for Gambit, and so on, so on. In the end, they just got too far ahead. And while we did see some good engages from Copenhagen Wolves, because they are so far behind, it's just not enough. And Gambit can always, even when they make a mistake, come back.
I just wonder if Gambit were to get the choice, of course, when they get that 7th place. Let's not forget there is a 6th place slot available. Exactly. Of course, the loser of the two quarterfinals will be in that. They're also going to slide in towards that promotion slot. That will be the number one promotion slot. They'll have the first choice. But I just wonder, if Gambit do get 7th, I wonder if they're going to pick NIP.
Well, if you look at yesterday's games between NIP and SK Prime, clearly SK Prime were the better team. So it would be NIP at the moment you would choose if you hadn't had a choice.
Or H2K.
Or H2K,
maybe sure,
but they might as well also be the team which whoever gets number 6 will pick. But we actually have to see the Challenger Finals also next week after the quarterfinals of LCS. We're going to have the Challenger Finals where we're of course going to see who is the strongest team, who do you want to avoid, and who can you pick.
Yeah, that's all going to be happening right here as well. Let's not forget along with those quarterfinals. A lot of matches still to play as the playoffs now are upon us. This final game of the season. Diamond's going to come around the side, and Limited is there. Didn't get jumped on, though. I was expecting Diamond to maybe pounce on that one. Guardian Angel now picked up by him. Nick himself, he's got a Zonya's Hourglass, which is vital because, of course, he's been caught out so many times by that Shockwave. Kubon working down this turret. I think Yubonk might be able to save it. I think he should be able to clear this wave out.
Not exactly killing it fast.
No, exactly. It's he can only slowly scratching with his bark. But this bottom wave, that's the focus. That's where Gambit want to push in. Baron up in 40 seconds time. So it's going to be a cautious attack, I feel, on this turret.
There's no flashing Genja, so Gambit can actually move up to the tower. At least it would be very risky because of the potential engage from Copenhagen Wolves. So just going to stay here and hope Kubon can actually do anything up in his one-on-one with Yeongbok. Gambit can just wait for Baron. They need Flash ready for Genja. They need a Guardian Angel. And they need a Baron buff. Then they can go win.
So, Gambit. What will they do? Yeongbok actually pushed out, by the way, quite far against Kubon in that top wave. Hasn't gone too aggressive, though. This is the focus. Diamond takes... I think he got caught with a dark bind in there. Yes, he did. Broken Shard jumps in. It's Eddie the focus. Nick turns back around. Didn't blow anyone up. Has held the trigger on that ultimate. Stun doesn't land either. Sorin was the focus target. Broken Shard was taken low.
Yeah.
Got to be careful here. Remember, with the Baron now up, if they were to lose a big fight here, the ball can easily jump in. Sorin, though, he gets dropped. Nick managed to pull that ultimate. Diamond's going to get blown away into safety by Woolite. Pounces back in. He's not done yet. He wants to finish it. Nick using the Zonya's Hourglass. Soul Shackle's not going to work out from Unlimited. He does not land it. Super Minions now. That's where they focus. They turn to the mid lane. Gambit keep on pushing. They're going to get themselves another inhibitor turret down, and they could take the in here, but I'm not too sure whether Wolves want to get close enough.
And the first engage from Copenhagen Wolves was onto Eddie, the support. I'm not sure why they used the javelin on him. He might go down here.
Broken Shard has to get away. Woolite going to be the focus. Diamond pounces, but he gets away. Teleport comes in. Kubon comes around the side there. Yeongbok can clean up here. Gets one, gets two. Can he get on towards it? Guardian Angel's going to come back up, and Yeongbok's into all sorts of trouble. Genja will not get away, and he's going to be safe. Genja just cleaning up. 619, so much damage on him now.
Stop jumping the support. He's not going to do anything to kill the support. Gambit, they keep fighting.
Oh, Woolite took down midair this time around by Genja. 719, Gambit in full control as they move on through. Kubon waits for the minions, and Gambit just two towers away and a Nexus to take the victory here. Kubon caught out, calling the Cataclysm by Broken Shard. Nick turns around, on Unlimited. Not going to be the focus target. They still don't go pushing in with the minions. They have to back away.
Can just back away and I go back, heal up, and then... Oh, Dungeon not done yet?
Oh, stun doesn't land. He
now
will just bounce away.
Now he is. Okay, Gamma can go back to base, heal up, wait for Eddie, go straight to Baron. They have super minions already going towards Copenhagen Wolves. They won't be able to go out and actually fight for this Baron buff unless it's going to be the last chance now for Copenhagen Wolves. Otherwise, Gamma can take it, push into the base, and look to finish here. But again before, Copenhagen Wolves jumping Eddie twice. Genji standing right next to him. It's like, nah, don't need him. Want Eddie. Just pure revenge here.
This little squishy AD carry is not the focus, not the one I'm looking for. Now, with their Guardian Angels, will be a big problem next fight. So, minion waves, super minions, shoving down the bottom lane. Yeongbok's off the side dealing with that. Hasn't got teleport, had to use it just a moment ago with this Baron spawn. That could be a bit of an issue. Baron started off, actually. Diamond didn't want that. Kubon goes in. They will start it off. So, Yeongbok, he's got to make tracks. He's a long way from this one. That explosive cast could be vital in this Baron fight. He's having to defend the turret. Hey, this is going to be the Baron for Gambit.
And then go up to this top one here. And just take the wave, push it up with him, and wait for all the super minions to pour into the base of Gambit. Like the base of Copenhagen Wolves.
Every single objective taken. Six out of six dragons, two out of two barons. Now 7-3 up in turrets. It's given this gigantic gold advantage, and from the very beginning, Gambit put the marker down. 3.5 minute dragon, they knew what they wanted. With that lane swap, which the Copenhagen Wolves initiated, has not worked out for them. Another turret falls. That's the eighth. The ninth is ready and waiting to fall. All 11 of them will be taken in this matchup. We're not sure that's the engage they're looking for. It will Diamond very, very low. Has to use his ultimate. Doesn't obviously give him any mitigation anymore, so I'm not sure why he triggered it. Just simply wants to get himself away from that one. We'll have a bit of regen. Goes in towards the jungle, actually, to get the lifesteal on that one. So he will be okay for now.
Gambit staying in his top lane. Look at the super minions coming towards the base of Copenhagen Wolves here. They have to send someone into defend. Opens up now for Gambit to go in towards the tower. Unlimited took a lot of damage, and Diamond already back to full HP.
Yes. Void spikes and, of course, the Baron buff giving him all of that lifesteal as he clears out the jungle. Goes back in. Super minions on towards the Nexus turrets right now. Gambit just delaying this one. Then Nexus turrets will fall. You can see Youngbuck's had to go back to deal with them. While Gambit, there's one Nexus turret down. He can't keep them away from this. They're trying to do all they can. The inhibitor turret's now falling. Genja's getting another range. Couple of shots on towards it. Every time stepping away, that shockwave could be the big key item. But he's just not able to pull the trigger. They've got to deal with the super minions. Once again, they go around the side. Nexus turrets keep feeling the pressure as Gambit just delay and delay on this one. The Wolves, once again, Genja goes in, gets himself another free shot. Sorin taking yet more damage, has to pull a defensive ball. And immediately, the second it happens, Genja goes in, gets a couple more shots. Inhibitor has finally spawned. That's the bottom wave, but that's going to get cleared out. There's the inhibitor turret going down. Gambit continuing to keep the pressure on as they just force the Wolves.
The Wolves have to engage.
They have to do something or they're just simply going to lose this game. Passively, that's not the way they want to go out, surely. Woolite takes the focus. Now they're going to try and push out. You can see Gambit just rallying, getting ready. Genja's going to be the focus, quickly clawing away. That's the ultimate use. Explosive cast went down on that one. They flash death sentence on Broken Shard. Will he get followed through? Inhibitor respawns. Diamond pounces. Woolite gets away just about with the heal. That's going to be Inhibitor going down. Gambit continue to pressure onto the Copenhagen Wolves. Ultimate went onto Unlimited. Not really the ideal focus, but it doesn't matter. It forces them back to the fountain. Death sentence once again thrown out from Eddie. Another inhibitor falls, and Gambit doing everything they can now. Broken Shard, he's getting focused on. Genji needs to start getting a couple of those auto attacks. Woolite is going to focus on. Woolite has to jump away. Youngbuck in trouble. Youngbuck follows through. Woolite, Youngbuck is going to get focused down. Broken Shard gets locked up. Gambit are going to take this one, ladies and gentlemen. They will secure seventh place. They will get the choice of their opponent in the promotion series, and the Copenhagen Wolves, sadly, will be eighth place for them as Genji just cleans up at the end here on towards the fountain. The Nexus will fall, double teleport from Kubon. And Gambit Gaming, they follow and finish in style.
Very well played and really showed how good Gambit looked in this Super Week. Just a standard game for them, to be honest. If you look at the last four games they have played, full control of Dragon. And I have to say, MVP, I know Genji picked up a lot of kills, but MVP is the man in front. Definitely Edward here for me. The lanterns were perfect to save Genja. He set up so many kills early game, which gave Dragons, which gave the goal lead for Gambit. He just set up everything.
Excuse me while I take a breather.
You talk for like 2 minutes.
8-1-10 Genja at the end of that one. Fantastic. Where's this Genja been, ladies and gentlemen? Cogmore, the champion of choice.
Where's
him,
the support been?
Where has Eddie been? Big Boss Eddie throwing out death sentences like he meant it. And when they landed, by God, did that champion go down. So fantastic play overall from all of Gambit this time around. You know, Kubon solid in the top lane. Yeah. He really has stepped up, proved, you know, of course, he had the experience from Meet Your Makers previously in the LCS, but really is a solid champion in the top lane. More importantly, he gives Diamond the choice to actually choose where he's going to go instead of having
exactly,
basic lane.
And we did see Gambit just give the Gragas over to Copenhagen Wolves. Like, we don't actually need it. We can just play Maokai top lane. Yes, he fell behind early, but once he got his tanky items, it was all they needed because the rest of the team, all the focus on bottom lane, once again, pays off. It's where they get the kills. It's what it gives the Dragons. And Gambit, with the new playstyle, a lot of focus on poking. And once they get the lead, they put up so many wards. Copenhagen Wolves could never really move anywhere. Gambit would know. Catch him once again from Eddie. And another kill, another objective. And very, very strong performance. They're not done yet. They still have to requalify. But at least now, they have the option to choose whatever or one of the teams they want to face.
I mean, let's not be wrong. This is a long way from facing the Taipei Assassins in the semi-finals at Season 2 Championships for Gambit, of course. But they are still safe. They have to go through that best of five. It's a big, big fight, of course, in the promotion series. But after looking at their display in Super Week, I think they could nail it. They went 4-1 effectively this Super Week. It's been brilliant for them.
Looked very, very good. Beat a lot of the middle of the pack teams. So yeah, going into promotion tournament, all of a sudden now, Gambit might be one of the favorites to actually qualify.
Well, let's get over to stage. Shox is standing by. We're one of the winners. It is Nick from Gambit.
Pleasure talking to Nick. Congratulations once again. You guys were very confident going into this matchup, yet a very calm and collected objective game. Talk us through strategy.
Yeah, so generally Copenhagen Wolves forced the swap, which obviously forced the slow game, because if you swap, you actually lose Drake control for the first Drake, which we abused. We got the first Drake, at the second minute. Yeah. And pretty much that's it. We just forced the Drake fights, which were in favor of us mostly. And just a few times also, we were waiting for the catch-up. We have Syndra, we have Thresh, and generally either I or Edward was landing the hooks or stuns, and we killed people.
Talk us through your pick for Syndra here versus Soren's Orianna, a champion he loves so much, and other teams actually have banned out versus him a lot.
Orianna is a very safe matchup, obviously, and it's also Soren most played, so he's obviously quite good on her. They banned Ziggs, which is like my safest champion, so I had to go for something more aggressive, and they also swapped, so I couldn't have for the early game help of the diamond. Yeah, so it went for farming in the middle and transitioned into catching the people.
So fantastic game from you guys. Once again, fantastic record here in Super Week, securing that 7th-place spot. When I talked to the other guys, they were actually looking ahead to next year already and not even thinking about the struggle of re-qualifying maybe. How do you look up on the promotion games?
Before this week, or even before the last week, it was a bit hard for us because we couldn't quite find the connection and everything, but right now we stayed in Cologne for like before a week right now, and the last week we trained really hard. Obviously it came with quite good effects, so we are just trying to do the same for relegations and secure our spot.
Well, you guys looked fantastic. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right, it's time to wrap up Super Week, so let's go over one more time to the dynamic duo of D-Man and Officio.
Thank you very much, Shox. So here we are, ladies and gentlemen. It is the end of the split. Currently, let's have a look at the standings and see where everything has lied. Alliance, they have maintained control of first place for the entire split and look like the team to beat coming into the playoffs, of course. Fnatic, well, they've led a record-breaking reckless at the end of the split. Only equaled the record, though.
Yeah.
Didn't quite take it from ManCloud. The Super Bowl crew, well, they sit in a hard-fought third place. It's been a tough, tough Super Week for them, though.
Yeah, and then we have SK Gaming, pretty good Super Week. And in this season, actually, is number 4 in the standings here, while Millennium went 0-4, terrible Super Week for them, and in the split in 5th place. Rocket, they round out the middle of the table now with 6th place and, of course, are in the playoffs. And despite their struggles, Gambit Gaming in the season as number 7, while Broken Shard and the Copenhagen Wolves fall all the way down to last place.
And that, of course, means that the bracket is ready for the playoffs to begin. As a reminder, of course, the Super Hawk crew and Rocket will be kicking things off in the quarterfinals next Thursday, August 7th, and the winner will face Fnatic in the semifinals at Gamescom.
And then we have the SK Gaming vs. Millennium match, which takes place on Friday, August 8th. And with that winner, heading to Gamescom as well to play against the number 1 team in Europe at the moment, Alliance.
There were, of course, a lot of improvements, ladies and gentlemen, across Super Week, but let's take a look at 5 players who performed consistently across all of their matches. In the top, well, it's the man we just saw in action. What a fantastic week it's been for Kubon. Overall, he really has stepped up.
Yeah, it was a tough start for him, getting into the LCS again, playing for Gambit, but he's really been performing here in Super Week. Marco seems to be his new number 1 pick in the top lane and really works. Love to play the tanks.
Well, alongside him is a man that's had the freedom, honestly. 4 Kha'Zix's and 1 Evelynn overall, of course, including the tiebreaker. It is Diamond. What a turnaround it's been for this man. Everyone was questioning him just 2-3 weeks ago. Wow, what a turnaround. 7.3 KDA.
And also looks very happy when he plays now and seems to have a lot of synergy with both Nick and Kubon here. So solo laners working out, and all of a sudden, he's ganking the bottom lane as well. So seems to me like Diamond, he's back as we used to see him, especially his Evelynn game against SK Gaming was perfect.
Yeah, got three kills straight away at the start. All about that blue pot. The mid lane, well, it's the man from Fnatic. We all know who he is. It is Peke. Had a fantastic week once again. Xerath pulled out earlier on. Brilliant stuff from him. Also, Fizz.
Yeah, his Fizz play was pretty much perfect also in the game against Copenhagen Wolves. Yes, he did play around a little bit, but every single time it mattered, he went in, picked up some kills, and Fnatic and Xpec are looking to really peak at the right time.
Well, perhaps if he had give a couple of those kills to Reckless, we wouldn't
have tied the record. One.
Well, AD carry, it's not Reckless, ladies and gentlemen, it's Candy Panda, because he has been brilliant. 22 kills and 22 assists with 3 wins and 1 loss.
Such a good performance by him and SK Gaming. And we know, whenever he performs, SK Gaming can always win teamfights. And if you can also get a triple kill with your passive, you are doing pretty well.
The thing is, SK arguably probably had the hardest Super Week, of course. They beat both Fnatic and Alliance as well, the top two slots. Support is Yellow Style from Fnatic. He has had a brilliant game. And of course, we all saw that last matchup that they played. He pulled out Morgana.
And it worked. AP Morgana for Yellowstar really showing he can play whatever he wants. This is from the support game, however.
Five-man Soul Shackle. Yeah, brilliant
stuff. Them, beautiful setup. And every single game Fnatic plays, Yellowstar is the guy who just sets up kills left and right, and the guy who controls the entire map.
Today's LCS big play there, of course. The single most valuable player for this Super Week was the man we just saw. It was Yellowstar. What a fantastic performance it's been for him once again. His Morgana was spectacular. Landed Soul Shackle after Soul Shackle, like multiple members. I think 4 in the Baron Pit, 5 in the Dragon Pit.
Everyone got just stunned by him. And he is the best support in Europe. Question is he better than Aphromu over on NA? We're going to have to see doing Worlds if CLG and Fnatic can qualify. Because at the moment, they are very, very close. And honestly, Yellowstar is clearly the number one supporter in Europe.
Well, Yellowstar actually had a tweet that highlighted his biggest play of the week. This came in for Fnatic Yellowstar, and he said, that Baron stealing triple kill was for all the ladies out there, ladies and gentlemen.
Learning from his AD carry.
Let's take a look at that big play.
They dive into it. Reckless now has gone to the halfway point of the map. Can they get it? They can! Fnatic steal the Baron! It's Yellowstar that gets that one. His ulti's running in the pit, and this is going to be a whitewash. Reckless coming in. That's one kill. That's two, three kills for Yellowstar.
Well, I think honestly, Joe pretty much hit the nail on the head. He was like, that's one. Why is Yellowstar getting all the kills and not Reckless?
He can do whatever he wants, even steal the Baron as Morgana, which is pretty impressive.
I think Reckless needs to be looking towards Yellowstar and saying, it's all your fault. I could have been the record breaker, but instead, I just evened it out. There are, of course, still 16 LCS games to be played this week in North America. They're going to be kicking off tomorrow with Curse versus Complexity.
And they'll end their first day with Counter Logic Gaming going up against Team Dignitas. And the North American Challenger Summer 2 finals will take place after those matches as Team Coast take on Curse Academy for the title. Those matches start on Saturday at 9 p.m. Central European Summer Time, 12 noon Pacific.
And then next Thursday, the European LCS playoffs will begin. The first quarterfinals match will be live here in the studios.
And that series will be followed by the Challenger Series third place match, where the winner, of course, gets a spot in the promotion tournament. Everything starts with the LCS preview show at 4:30 p.m. Central European Summer Time or 7:30 a.m. Pacific. Smart thinking.
You're not going to want to miss that preview show, especially after the epic Super Week we've had here. And, of course, North America still to come. Lots of action to go into that one. That is all for the European LCS for this week, though. Thank you very much for joining us, and we'll be seeing you soon.
Them cheese because we're not chicken and we don't want beef, so we're ham.
Or
what?
It's ham or cheese, that's not chicken. Subtract force and the chicken.
Fuck.
Ignite is ticking away. Diamond has tanked up the turret. That's a double coming in for Genja. And Svenskeren will fall as well. Triple kill for Genja.
Oh no, it's a me, Mario.
The knock-up doesn't quite land onto Cocoon does, but there is a Baron picked up, stolen away by the Super Hot crew, and that was amazing from Impaler, and now they just turn onto Millennium. Reckless needs 14 kills from this game to beat ManCloud's record.
Two.
One more.
Maokai. Lee.
No.
You got that?
No.
Selfie goes in pretty deep. Mime has been caught out. He's gone towards Wallite. Wallite will not take him down. Now we're going to see Mr. Rales cleaning up. He gets one, gets two.
It is Alliance versus Millennium, and we'll see how these two very diverse team comps work out.
It's a little unseen from them. There goes the Glacial Fisher. There's Frogger going in, and Millennium just got wrecked. Absolutely destroyed them.